All right, welcome to our latest Bible study. When we last left off right where Luke 16 begins. So we're going to do a Bible study, and basically what we do, guys, is I go through the Bible study and we'll stop along the way and we'll chat about different things. And it's awesome that we can read about the most famous person in world history, Jesus Christ. Imagine God puts himself into the tenthly flesh of this man, Jesus Christ, and he is God walking among us. So, we're going to read what Jesus Christ said, and this is our continuing series of things Jesus said that may shock you. I used to be an atheist, and when I started reading about the words that Jesus Christ said, it radically changed me, and I just think it's awesome. I think that the words are spiritual, the things that Jesus said. So let's go through this. And you know why we do these Bible studies, guys, is because if you're thirsty, what do? You get some water, you drink some water, and your thirst is quenched. When you're physically hungry, what do? You feed your belly, and the hunger pains go away. But many of us don't really take the time to feed ourselves spiritually. And so there's a saying that says, if you could see it, it's not going to last. It is the things that we cannot see that last forever, these spiritual things. So I think you're very wise and intelligent to invest your time, like you're going to do right now, in spiritual things. Remember, Jesus said, don't lay up your treasure where moth and dust corrupt it. He said to lay up your treasure in heaven. So let's do this. Let's feed ourselves spiritually. So here we go. Jesus is there with his disciples, and what Jesus would do, if you've never read scriptures before, he would speak to them in parables, sort of like little stories, little examples, and it's brilliant the way that he spoke, because it makes it easier to remember what he said. And he said also unto his disciples, we're reading Luke 16, there was a certain rich man which had a steward, and the same was accused unto him that he had wasted his goods. And he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear this of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest be no longer steward. So what's happening here is this man basically is working for the rich man, and he's basically wasting the rich man's goods. He's responsible for taking care of the rich man's goods and, you know, investing them wisely, so forth and so on. So what you have here is he's basically calling in this steward and he's questioning him, right? So look what the steward says. He says, what shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. I cannot dig to beg. I am ashamed. So he's basically begging the rich man, you know, please don't let me go, right? I am resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So, excuse me. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him, and said unto the first, how much owest thou unto my Lord? And he said, 100 measures of oil. And he said unto him, take thy bill and sit down quickly and write 50. So what you see this steward doing is he's getting busy, like, you know, working on account of the rich man, his boss, so to speak. So he's getting into gear here, going to work. Then he said to another, how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said unto them, take thy bill and write 80. And the Lord commended the unjust steward, because he had done wisely. So basically what happens is this steward, he thinks wisely, and he says, well, you know what, I'm gonna tell some of these people that owe his boss, the rich man, well, look, what can you pay today? You know, and he basically does good for the rich man. So notice the Lord commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. And then Jesus says, for the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. And I say to you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when you fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much, and he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to you your trust the true riches? So you see what Jesus is saying here. This is an epic quote here. Look at Luke 16:11. He's saying basically, like, if you're unfaithful in the unrighteous mammon, what's that? You know, money, you know, your money, what you do with it. He says, who will commit to you your trust the true riches, which is what? Spiritual things. It's interesting that he kind of shows that. So, like, in other words, if people are blowing their money on booze, alcohol, they're just wasting, you know, they're not investing their money wisely into spiritual things. It's just unrighteous mammon, like he says. The true riches are the spiritual thing. So then he says here, and if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. So, you know, you can't be all obsessed about money, and likewise, if you're obsessed about God, you won't be all obsessed about money. And the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things, and they derided him. So, you know, Jesus is talking specifically about people like the Pharisees. So now Jesus confronts them, and he said unto them, yea, are they, in other words, you are they which justify yourselves before men. So the Pharisees were more concerned what men thought about them than God. He says, but God knows your hearts, for that which is highly esteemed among men, check this out, guys, that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God. Interesting. You know, ego, riches, financial success, you know, arrogance, confidence in human endeavors and stuff. So notice he says, that's not to say that being rich is sinful, but notice he's saying for that which is highly esteemed among men, in other words, where the end all, cure all is, you know, getting wealthy and famous, etc. It says, that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it. And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one tittle of the law to fail. Whosoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth adultery, and whosoever marrieth her that is put away from her husband committeth adultery. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. Now, I believe this is actually a true story that Jesus is telling here. And purple is like a sign of, you know, royalty and wealth. And then he talks about this person that's rich, and he's clothed in purple and fine linen, and he fared sumptuously every day. So he ate very good food and lived the good life. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. And it's kind of like a little sad picture here. And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. There was a spiritual place called Abraham's bosom. A lot of people will ask me this. They'll say, well, where did people go, you know, before heaven and hell? You know, where did they go, you know, before Jesus Christ? And, you know, and if you were a righteous person, and you found favor in God's eyes, you would go to the spiritual place of Abraham's bosom where you'd be comforted, right? But notice the rich man also died and was buried. Now, notice Jesus talks about hell, okay? He says, and in hell, and this is, listen guys, this is sweet, meek, gentle Jesus saying this. In fact, do you know Jesus talks about hell a lot? When I go through scripture, and you actually should do this, he talks about hell, judgment, more than any other person in the Old and the New Testament. So notice Jesus' warning of this. He says, and in hell he lifted up his eyes. Who did? The rich dude here. Now watch. Being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water, and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. Now this is Jesus saying this, guys. Now watch this. It appears there's a great divide where once you're in hell, you can't escape it. Watch this. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. So notice the rich guy was living the good life, but Lazarus just had a horrible life. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, here it is, look, it's interesting. Jesus says, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed. Notice, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, now watch this. So the rich guy, he comes to his senses here and he says, I pray thee therefore, Father, he's talking to Abraham, that thou wouldst send to him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, he's saying, that he may testify unto them. In other words, go warn my brothers. You guys ever see that movie they always play around Christmas time, you know, the Ebenezer Scrooge movie, where one of Scrooge's old business partners comes back and is warning Scrooge. Well, what happens, a lot of movies, they'll take things out of the Bible, they'll get ideas from the Bible, and so like when you read the Bible, you're thinking, oh well, that's like from the movie, but it's really the other way around. They've taken things from the Bible and they've made movies out of it. So I bet that guy that wrote that, what is it called, like A Christmas Carol, whatever, they made a movie out of that book with Ebenezer Scrooge, I bet they got that part from this, because remember how the guy goes back to Ebenezer Scrooge and he warns him not to be wicked like how he was, and he's all in chains and stuff. Remember that? Because look, he's saying he wants to go warn his brothers that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But look what Abraham says unto them. They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. But notice Abraham says, look, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Good point. Let's go to the next page. Okay. Luke 17. Jesus says, Then he said unto his disciples, It is impossible that offenses will come, but woe unto him though whom they come. In other words, Jesus is saying, look, there's going to be problems in life, but woe to the troublemaker who causes them to come. Notice what he says, okay? This phrase here, little ones, these little ones, which I'm going to talk to you about, it's also a lot of biblical scholars believe that this is a phrase of new believers, new little ones, little children in Christ that have become new believers. Look what Jesus says. Listen, guys, sweet, meek, gentle, loving Jesus says this. He says, it were better for him who, he says, it is impossible but that offenses will come, but woe unto him through whom they come. I'm telling you guys, you don't mess around with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You better not even dare try to turn people away from Jesus Christ. You're messing on pretty dangerous ground when you do this. Look what Jesus says. It were better for him who, the person that tries to turn people away from Jesus Christ, right? That a millstone were hanged about his neck. And this millstone is not like just a little rock. It's a huge stone. You couldn't even lift it. It's a millstone. You should do some research on it. He's like, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he cast into the sea. This is Jesus saying this. He says, better to do that than that you should offend one of these little ones. So you have this very strict warning from Jesus Christ. He says, so take heed to yourselves. In other words, don't mess up. If thy brother trespass against thee, rebuke him, and if he repent, forgive him. But look at this. And if he trespass against thee seven times a day, and seven times in a day turn again to thee, like he asks you to, you know, sincerely seven times, you know, please forgive me. Jesus says again, you shall forgive him. And this is excellent. Look what the disciples ask, or the apostles say unto Jesus, Lord, increase our faith. Excellent thing to ask for. And look what Jesus says. And the Lord said, if you had faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say unto this sycamine tree, be thou plucked up by thy root, and be thou planted in the sea, and it should obey you. But which of you, having a servant plowing or feeding cattle, will say unto him by and by when he has come from the field, go and sit down to meat, and will not rather say unto him, make ready wherewith I may sup, and gird thyself and serve me till I have eaten and drunken, and afterward thou shalt eat and drink? Doth he thank that servant because he did the things that were commanded him? I trow not. So likewise ye, in other words, if we do the things that Jesus commands us, that's just what's expected of us. We should say we're just doing what we should do. You know, we shouldn't pat ourselves on the back or anything like that. He says, so likewise ye, when you shall have done all the things which are commanded to you, say, we are unprofitable servants. Look at the humbleness. Jesus wants us to have this humbleness. We have done which was our duty to do. And it came to pass, this is really good here, as he went into Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee, and as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers. Okay, now you should go read up on leprosy. It's just a horrible, painful skin disease. Contagious, like if you don't want to touch lepers. And notice, which stood afar off. And a lot of history, when you read about leprosy, they would have to cry out, unclean, unclean, as you're walking kind of towards their direction so you can walk far away from them. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So picture this. Imagine 10 men there. They're kind of all hanging out with each other because they can't hang out with people that don't have leprosy, right? So they all have leprosy. Here comes Jesus, and these 10 men are asking him, really, it's pretty sad here, you know, they're just in pain and agony. They're asking, look, have mercy on us. Now watch this. When he saw them, he said unto them, go shew yourselves unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. So as they're going to the priest, they're cleansed. Now, this is really interesting. Let's say you had leprosy all this time. I mean, wouldn't it just be common sense and just human dignity and respect to God to return to Jesus and thank him? I mean, wouldn't it be just, you know, wouldn't that just follow that anyone with even a little bit of heart and compassion would be so happy that they would go back to Jesus and say thank you? But watch this. Some things never change, guys. Look. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back. But look at it says up here, as they went, they were cleansed. So they're all cleansed, but only one of them comes back and gives glory to God. And look at how he does it. And with a loud voice, glorified God. He does the right thing. This guy, this dude here, this ex-leper, he's grateful. He's not ashamed of God. He's not ashamed of glorifying God. With a loud voice, he's doing it. And then he comes up to Jesus Christ. He falls down on his face, right at Jesus' feet. Now notice this. There's other parts of Scripture where the disciples, they heal people, and when they start worshiping the disciples stop them because it's sinful for, you know, people to worship people. What's interesting in Scripture, wherever Jesus is worshipped, he allows it. He is God. He allows it. And here's another instance here. The guy falls down on his face right at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks, and look, and he was a Samaritan. And look what Jesus says. Were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God save this stranger? And he said unto him, arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Let's stop a second here and talk about this. You know, if you see the website shakanal.net on your screen right there, you should go there and click Passion of the Christ and watch that full movie. And what is kind of unusual to me, I don't understand it, and it kind of reminds me of this right here, is when you see what Jesus Christ went through, and when you see how he has given us eternal life, and then you see people just going on with their life. They don't really do like what this leper did, and thank him for it. It's amazing how like people just go on with their lives, like they don't have the common sense and the decency. I guess maybe they're so caught up in the world, you know. But you should watch that movie. It's very, very good. Now, Jesus tells a leper, go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole. And when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, this is really good right here. The Pharisees question him, when is the kingdom of God going to arrive? Look what Jesus says. This is pretty heavy. Look at this, guys. Jesus says, look, he says, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation. Whoa. In other words, he's like, the kingdom of God's not going to come by you observing it. Look what he says. He goes, neither shall they say, lo, here, like there it is, or there, or it's over here. Watch this. For behold, the kingdom of God is within you. And he said unto his disciples, the days will come when you shall desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you shall not see it. And he's referring to himself as the Son of Man. And they shall say to you, see here or see there. And look, in other words, they're basically lying, saying, there's Jesus. You know, he's returned, right? And he's talking about, I'll talk to you about this later when we do our Revelation series, where there'll be false Christ trying to trick people. And look what Jesus says. He warns people. He says, go not after them nor follow them. Okay? Then he explains how it's going to be when Jesus returns. He goes, "For as the lightning that lighteth out of one part under heaven shineth unto the other part under heaven, so shall also the Son of Man be in his day. But first he must suffer many things and be rejected of this generation." He's talking about him going to the cross. "And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man." Now this is heavy here too. Watch this. You know, a lot of people think that when Jesus returns, little by little, it's going to become so blatantly obvious that we're going to say, oh, any second now he's going to be back, and then and people will have time to repent, you know. And but that's not how it's going to be. Look what Jesus says. He says it's going to be like in the days of Noah when Jesus returns. What were they doing in the days of Noah? The people were still getting married. They were given in marriage. They were eating. They were drinking. They were just going on with their day. They were going to work. There was nothing. And look what Jesus says. And this is why I do believe also, not just the scientific evidence for the global flood, but I do believe the flood is historical, and also we're committed to admitting that the flood happened. Jesus refers to it. He says, "Until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise, also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all." So notice Jesus is referring to Sodom and Gomorrah. Remember the militant homosexual city? Remember in that moment where the angels come in, and angels will come in and they take on the appearance of men, and the homosexuals, the militant, perverse, nut job homosexuals of Sodom and Gomorrah, they wanted to rape the angels. Go ahead and type in Lot and Sodom and check it out. It's just unbelievable. And so Jesus is referring to when that Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed. And he says, "Even thus shall it be on the day when the Son of Man revealed." In other words, it's going to come where people are surprised. And you know what? When you read scripture, the flood came as a surprise. People were like shocked by it, even though people were warning against it. The destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah came as a surprise. It always comes as a surprise to those who are not ready. "In that day," Jesus says, "he which shall be upon the housetop and his stuff in the house, let him not come down to take it away. And he that is in the field, let him likewise not return back." Remember Lot's wife. Lot's wife was killed because she turned back. "Whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it, and whosoever shall lose his life shall preserve it. I tell you, in that night there shall be two men in one bed. The one shall be taken, and the other shall be left. Two women shall be grinding together. The one shall be taken, and the other left. Two men shall be in the field. The one shall be taken, and the other left." And they answered and said to him, "Where, Lord?" And here's this very bizarre phrase here, but you should look this up. It's very interesting. There's a whole sermon just on this. Look what Jesus says. Where are they going to be taken? Look what Jesus says, guys. He says unto them, "Wheresoever the body is, thither will the eagles be gathered together." All right, let's do. Now, this is interesting here. This is about you and I. If you have if you're going through a lot of troubles in your life, if you have a very strong prayer, how we should pray to God. If you know someone that is saying, "Well, I'm praying, you know, and nothing's happening," you know, look at what Jesus says here. This is really interesting, and I think we should take Jesus obviously at his word. Watch this. This is a very good example on how to pray. "And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. In other words, you keep praying. You don't give up. Saying, watch this. He says, there wasn't a city, a judge, which feared not God, neither regarded man. So this judge is like a big shot. He's not afraid of man. He's not afraid of God. He's like a person unto himself, right? He's got power. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him saying, avenge me of mine adversary. In other words, help me. I'm having problems with an adversary of mine. And he would not for a while. Okay? But watch what happens here, guys. This is what Jesus is saying, how we should pray to God. But afterward he said with himself, look, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, because she keeps going back asking him, he says, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, and then Jesus starts talking about when he returns for us, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? And let's finish up with this right here. This is good. And he spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. So I guess there's some people in the crowd, and they're very, very righteous and religious, right? They're like Pharisees, right? And so Jesus talks about those types of people, the very ultra religious, you know, people. And then he's talking about people like you and I, just the average Joe, you know. So he says, two men went up into the temple to pray. The one a Pharisee, that's the very ultra religious dude, and the other a publican. So this guy is just like the average Joe. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. So the religious guy is saying, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers. And then the Pharisee looks over at you and I, or even as this publican. And then watch how good this Pharisee is and how religious. He says, I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. So notice he's, you know, doing these rituals better than you and I. But then Jesus says, and the publican standing afar off would not lift up so much his eyes unto heaven. He realizes he's such a sinner, he's humbling himself, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And look what Jesus says. He goes, I tell you, this man, which man? the filthy, dirty, sinning publican. He said, this man went down to his house justified, rather than the other. Notice, for everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humble himself shall be exalted. Okay, notice what it says here, guys. What did the guy say? Notice he humbled himself. He was very, very sincere. He, you know, honored God. He couldn't even look up into heaven. And he said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. About seven words. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. 6-7 words there, if you want to count A as a word. I think it would be really good for all of us to humble ourselves and to sincerely say this. Look what Jesus said. He says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Now, guys, don't forget to go to shotgunnow.net and click entire audio Bible for free. And we left off at Luke 18, and you can listen to the rest of it. Let's just read this one last thing here, because this is really good, guys. Watch this. And it came to pass, as he was come nigh unto Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitude pass by, notice he can't see him, but he could hear him, he asked what it meant. Because he's like, man, all these footsteps going by, it's like a big mob, a big crowd. What is it? And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. Now, when he hears that, the guy goes nuts. He starts yelling, because he's heard of Jesus of Nazareth. He probably heard what happened with the lepers. So immediately look what this dude starts doing, the blind guy. He's like, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. He keeps saying it, crying out loud. And so probably, you know, we ever next to someone and that he's yelling so loud, or let's say, like, I went to Walmart today and there were some kids crying really loud in the store, you know, and so notice this. So imagine how loud a grown adult can yell, right? So this guy's crying, saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Imagine it. And so the people around, they're like, you know, they're probably thinking, man, this dude's acting like a bunch of trash. You know, he has no dignity and stuff. You'll hear yelling, and here comes Jesus. So look what the crowd says. They rebuked him. They're like, would you be quiet, you know, that he should hold his peace. But it has the reverse effect. Look, he says, but he cried so much the more. In other words, he's even getting into crying out louder and louder. Thou son of David, have mercy on me. And this part's epic. And Jesus stood, so he stops, right? So I bet when Jesus stopped, of course the crowd stops. So the man's probably hearing all this, and all of a sudden the crowd stops, right? Imagine how you're blind. Like, close your eyes right now. Go through this with me. And you hear all these footsteps, and you're crying and crying, and all of a sudden, all the footsteps stop. And you hear Jesus, he commands him to be brought unto him. And it's interesting, Jesus is always calling people to come to him. You notice that? And when he was come near, he asked him, and look at this. Jesus asked him again, and obviously everyone heard what he said, but there's a reason here why Jesus is asking him this. He wants to show the crowd this. Jesus says, what wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? What do you want me to do for you? It's like he gives you a blank check there. What do you want me to write it in for? Jesus is so awesome, guys. I love him so. And watch this. The guy, probably with tears streaming down his face, is like, finally he's, you know, standing in front of Jesus, Lord, that I may receive my sight. He's probably just physically exhausted. And Jesus simply says, receive thy sight. Thy faith hath saved thee. And immediately he received his sight, and notice, and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise unto God. And many of you guys watching this, you were blind like I was, but now we see, and it's awesome to see. So God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock. Have a great week.